So, thanks for having me. Good afternoon, everybody. I hope I have enough energy to keep the room awake after our good lunch. I'm Lisbeth Olbrechts. I'm head of product management for Enfocus. You may know us from products like Pitstop and Switch. And that's hopefully the last time I'll talk about our products, because I don't want to make this a sales session. This quote somehow defines me a bit. I'd rather have regrets about what I do than about what I don't do. I'm by education a chemistry engineer, somehow never ended up in that area. First half of my career, I worked for TomTom, managing software to automatically update geographical databases. And then I ended up in the graphical arts industry and have been here for 7 years somehow. So that's me. But I propose that we dive into the topic. The trend that we saw about 2 years ago was, it's the last call to automate. We were urging, ourselves included, urging everybody to start with automation. And now what we see after 2 years is that a lot of people have started with it. They're actually experimenting with what they can do. They're taking their first steps. Seeing what is possible along those lines. So I am going to talk about the trends that I see with our customers that have adopted automation and that are completing this, or that are doing this in a successful way. What are the things that we see? What are the behaviors that we see in those customers that are doing this successfully? So, but first, let's take a step back and have a look at the trends in the general technology landscape. And that's important because those trends are not that different from what we see in workflow automation. First and foremost, we see the rise of APIs. Traditionally, APIs, they've been a quick fix to make sure that incompatible software could talk to each other. Companies ask developers to create some kind of digital bridge between software applications that would otherwise not be able to talk to each other. And to explain how APIs work, I'm using a comparison I read somewhere in a blog, but you should think of it like this. You're sitting in a restaurant, you're looking at the menu, you have a choice between all kinds of different dishes, and you need to have a way to place your order in the kitchen. Now, you cannot talk to the chef directly because he's busy preparing food. So you need a way to get your message across. And then the waiter comes in. The waiter is actually your API. He transfers your order to the chef. And if everything goes well, he returns a message to you in the form of food. And if everything is designed correctly, then hopefully your food won't crash. That's basically how an API works. And over time, developers have used those APIs. They've taken the opportunity actually to break down software in containers. And APIs are basically an efficient way to get to have a direct path to essential data and/or features and/or services. And because of this, companies can provide a platform to outside developers to actually build applications on top of your platform, using APIs to get to the data and to the services that they need to make their application work on top of that, on top of your platform. And in many cases, we see that the APIs itself have become the product. Think about Amazon Web Services. That's where the product itself are the APIs. Why am I saying this? Because basically, the APIs are hugely important, and everything that you see, everything that's connected nowadays, it's all through APIs. And APIs are also democratizing. They're becoming more accessible. Typically, companies that offer an API, they'll offer the typical or traditional API for developers. But what we see is that a lot of these platforms are also offering plugins or widgets that allow you to make use of these APIs in an out-of-the-box way, without having to write one line of code. They're basically a way of acknowledging that API, the importance of API, and opening it up to a wider range of people, not only to technically skilled people. The second trend are the microservices. That's basically an architectural style that structures an application as a collection of services that can be maintained on its own. And of course, you need APIs to let the microservices talk to each other. And not go too much in detail because it's actually like a prolongation of the story of APIs. But then I come to a very important trend, and that's the trend of best of breed. It's basically making use of the best application in that field or in that particular area. And it's a bit a change from what we've seen, and especially we've seen that from our ERP vendors. Typically, the traditional ERP vendors, they were selling a massive system that would basically do everything for your company. That was the promise. And as long as you bought the whole system and paid a lot of dollars, you would be fine. That was the promise, that this product would be perfect for everybody. Well, it turns out that's not exactly the case. And why? Because if we're honest, you cannot be the best in everything. You can be the best in certain areas, but there is no way you can be the best in everything. And nowadays, people are acknowledging this. And printers like you, they want to use the best part. They want to use the best part for a particular application area. And of course, if you're going to do that, there is one essential consequence of that, and that's that you have to be able to connect those islands of automation that you've created. If you're using different kind of applications, then by nature, let's say, they will not be connected, but then it's up to you to have the right platform, to have the right middleware, to be able to let those different components talk to each other, and guess what, how do they do that? Through APIs. The next trend is the SaaS trend. I don't think that needs a lot of explaining. We all know that software as a service has been rising for a few years now. In my opinion, the biggest driver for this is the flexibility. And of course, there are other upsides to that, to SaaS as well, like the reduced IT costs and the reduced management of your technology. But in my personal opinion, it's the flexibility that comes with subscriptions and a software as a platform that is a vast driver for the rise of SaaS. And then you have big data and AI. There is a very interesting session on AI after mine, so I will again not go too much into detail, but what we see is that through the network effect, there is a lot more access to data. And what enables, what is the enabler for AI? That's data. And this is all because software applications are opening up through APIs. You have access to all kinds of data, which in its turn enables AI. But the biggest denominator of all of this is the connectivity through APIs. I hope by now I've said the word API enough for you to remember that APIs are important. When we then take the bridge to the printing technology and workflow automation, that's why we're here, is that basically the trends that we see in the general technology landscape are not that different from the workflow automation landscape. We also see SaaS, we see APIs, we see AI, we see best of breed kind of behavior. And important to acknowledge is that these are very technical trends which are coming your way. Now, before we had this magical product, a very big product that was perfect for everybody. You had to install it and you were good to go in theory. Now the automation software, or the automation platform is actually a better word, should be flexible and should only be a starting point. It should be the basis for everything that you build on top of that. It's almost like a living thing. It will continuously evolve, at least if you're part of the ones who are doing it right, in our humble opinion. Does this mean that you as a printer should now hire a development team and start really developing your own software on top of these automation platforms? Definitely not. But the most important part is that you have access to technical knowledge. And this can either be in-house. If you're lucky, then you have a tech-savvy person in-house that can imagine what automation can do for you. But just as important, this can be a person outside of your company in the form of a very good integrator or technical reseller. These people are, they know about these trends, they know about the technology, they know in a lot of cases about your production, they've done it before, they are your first line of help, they can help you with this journey. So the most important thing to remember is that you need to have access to technical skills. Not necessarily own it, but at least have access to that. And of course, the side effect that we see, we as a vendor, is that the sales process has become more technical. In the old days, if I may call it like that, you had the business owner talking to a vendor, and then they discussed the value it could bring, the pains, and you signed the contract, and that was it. What we now see from us as a vendor point of view is that it's no longer just the business owner. No, it's the business owner together with production people, together with people from IT, together with really technical people that are part of the sales process. And it's a good thing because it means that you as a printer are thinking about what this means for your technology stack in your company. So while we see it as a change, it's a good change and it's probably there to stay. So this is the general trends in technology. I try to make a bridge to the trends in workflow automation. Now, what are the behaviors that we see in customers who are doing this automation project right? Is that they almost treat their automation as a team member. And I'm going to use this analogy throughout the rest of this presentation. We think that you should treat your automation as a team member. And of course, the first step when you want to add a new team member is you select, write open a vacancy and you select the right candidate. It's the same thing in automation. The first thing you have to do is select your platform. And when you're, especially nowadays, due to the digital transformation, the far most important thing in an employee, in a lot of the domains, I would not say all, but in a lot of the domains, is that employee is flexible. Why? Because the world is constantly changing, and very rapidly so. So the truths that you know today are no longer necessarily the truth that you know in a few years from now. But the one thing you cannot do is each year change your employees. So you need to have employees which are flexible and which you can trust, can adapt to a future situation. And that's basically the same thing that you have to expect from your automation platform. It has to be flexible to adapt to future needs because basically we cannot be sure what the future holds. This is both from a technology point of view as from your own business point of view. Your business is evolving. If you're doing well, you're probably diversifying. So you're continuously adding print services. You need to be able to integrate this as well. There is never an as-is situation because tomorrow that is situation is gone. Now, before, what we saw is that a lot of vendors had their own file format and their own proprietary technology and hardware. This is changing, and you should definitely select a platform that is able to deal with standards. We talked enough about APIs, REST APIs, there are webhooks, there are a number of other technologies or standards that you can use. And I always give the example of WebEx. We in Infocus, at some point, we decided to move away from WebEx. WebEx is a technology that we use for our webinars, where customers can call in and they view a presentation and so on. And of course, what you want to do is share that session afterwards with the people who were there. Now, WebEx for a long time had their own proprietary format to download the session in. But that makes it very hard for us to share, because everybody then needs a special viewer and so on. So at the moment we decided to leave WebEx, they finally made the change, and they are now making their recordings available in a traditional and a standard video format, which again makes it easy for us to share. So for us, this really triggered to change our decision and to stay with WebEx. In the meantime, we've changed it for other reasons, but that's a side note. So working with standards, very important. This, yeah, I just wanted to invite you all, if you have a few minutes, to ever look at a session from the product manager of Switchtone, who was actually talking about the future-proofness, if this is actually a word, about the automation platform, and that no platform can actually be future-proof without APIs. But it goes further than that. We always try to be proactive when it comes to integrating new technology. The last thing, or one of the examples is, for example, when we integrated webhooks. That was, we didn't see at that point of time that a lot of third parties were using webhooks, but from the moment the vendor started doing that, yeah, we were ready and it was easy for us to integrate, which gave us a head start. Then if you selected your platform, then or if you selected your employee, the first thing you will do is let him or her do the easy tasks. It's kind of obvious, of course. You first want to do the easy task, get to some small successes, share that with the other employee, show the value of the new team member, raise the confidence. And of course, very important here is take care of the change management. It's funny because we talked about this during lunch. I don't have a magic answer here. The only thing we can keep on repeating is visibility. And the most important thing here, maybe, is that it's actually talk to your employees, talk to your production people, because they are the ones who will tell you what are those easy tasks which are worth automating first. And also observe them, because in a lot of cases, it's become such a part of their everyday doing that they don't realize actually that they're just doing repetitive tasks. So listen to them, observe them, and it will become very clear what are those early first tasks to automate. And it can be anything. It can be from automating some pre-flight checks to automate retrieval from files from FTP, or creating folder structure, rename jobs, whatever, very easy things. Now, the second, and this is a very important step, and I'm assuming that most of you have already started with these very easy steps in automation, is now you need to be inspired to go beyond those quick wins and those easy steps at first. And important here is that you create actually an automation roadmap. I'm just looking at the timekeeper. Am I okay? Because I started my presentation earlier, so I don't have a... Okay. You have to create an automation roadmap, and very important for that are the goals that you attach to that. You have to define a roadmap with KPIs. For those who are not familiar with that, those are key performance indicators. And it's actually like your aspiration, your goal expressed in numbers, basically. For that, to achieve that goal, you need to create a roadmap towards achieving that goal. But the only way you can create a roadmap is, of course, knowing where you start. And that's a vital component. So you need to map out your processes in order to know what are the problems you really want to attack and you really want to solve. In a lot of cases, this is also about identifying the data gaps that you have. Because if you want to quantify a goal, you have to know how you are doing today. Quantifying a goal means that you kind of label what good looks like. That's your goal. But in order to reach that, you have to know what gap you have to close. And of course, you need to know what you are doing right now. Suppose that your goal is that 60% of your jobs should be automatically associated with a job ticket number automatically, let's say, then you need to know for how many jobs this is the case right now. And also, if you're putting KPIs, if you're putting quantifiable targets on your roadmap, also choose them wisely. If you're a complete web-to-print company, then probably your KPI might be something like, I want more than 98% of the total jobs to be no-touch jobs, can be. But if you're more like a diverse or a printer with a diverse product range with specialty print and so on, then a total number might not make sense, and you are more looking towards an average jobs, average amount of jobs with no touch. So choose your KPI wisely, And always make sure that you are expressing this in a way you can measure it. That's the most important thing. Now, if you are going on the automation route, another very important part is to name an automation champion. And this is a tech-savvy person who really is creational or creative about knowing what automation can do for your company, who sees the possibilities. And again, this can be an internal or an external person. If you're lucky, then you have this in-house. And this is not necessarily a developer. This can be a person who knows about XML and JavaScript and APIs, often is a person who is a gadget freak or a gamer or something, somebody who has this tech savviness in him and has skills that can develop along that way. If you're not that lucky and you don't have this in-house, you can either bring in a person or, again, you can go to integrators. They are the ones who, what we see from our customers is that these integrators, they are so knowledgeable about your production from the moment you start doing projects with them that if you're progressing along your automation roadmap, it's just a phone call away. They know what you're talking about and it goes very quickly. So again, tech-savvy person, in-house or outside, it doesn't really matter. Of course, if you're setting goals, then it's obvious that you are evaluating against those the progress of those roadmap, of that roadmap and those goals. It means it's nothing more than like we in our company, we have yearly performance objectives. And it's basically an aspiration of where you want to be after a year, what are the tasks you need to do to get there, and then every quarter, every 6 months or every 2 weeks, depending on your maturity, we're checking off where that employee is against those targets. It's the same for your automation. And again, together with the evaluation of your goals, you should also of your progress, you should also reassess your goals or your targets, meaning that sometimes you've advanced faster than you anticipated. Then you need to be able to change the targets and set them right for the progress you've made so far. If you are encountering more problems, you might want to downscale them a bit. It all depends on how is it going for you. And then the last step, and I really didn't have a good title for this. I put the sky as the limit because this is the stage where you've done the easy tasks, you've set up the structure you need to have in your company to continue with your automation. And this is all about linking the islands of automation, linking new software components, making use of the data that's in your MIS to steer your production. This is about making it smarter, adding more data. It's the sky is the limit. There are numerous examples that I will not start to give them all. But this is really the point where you want to be, because this is also where if people start to diversify their portfolio, you have new workflows that you need to integrate, you have new software components that you need to offer those new services, and of course you want to immediately incorporate them in your workflow automation as well. And then the last slide is a bit about the benefits of success if you do this successfully. The one thing we always see is that if you do automation successfully, it frees up resources. And most of our customers use these resources for growth. I have one company in mind which is a bit on an extreme of the spectrum, but it's a UK company that started this automation journey, and they basically, their target was to have 100% no-touch jobs. And they actually sold a part of their business to their competitor because that business wouldn't allow for no-touch jobs. So they really made a decision to go all in on no-touch jobs. Now, that's a bit of an exception. Most of our customers, they free up resources and they're able to expand their product portfolio to offer new services. So this is really a positive story. It enables growth. Growth without having to add FTEs. FTEs are full-time equivalents. Sorry for the acronyms. It's healthy growth. It's not growing by just throwing heads at it. It's growing because you have the margin to do so. It's, of course, increased employee satisfaction because basically nobody's really happy doing repetitive tasks. It's less stress. It's a general feeling of not always being late, not always scrambling. It's this proactivity which makes people happy. And it's also something that we've seen that a lot of our customers take this as an opportunity to rethink their price setting. Some people take this in margin and have a bigger margin. Other ones change their prices to be more competitive and gain extra share. You see all kinds of behaviors, but it really, if they are progressing on this automation journey, they always take one moment in time to rethink the price setting. And of course, there are no more boring tasks and less errors. Of course, you're catching things earlier on in the process. So definitely an important consequence. So I'm going to conclude here. I hope you liked it a bit. I know there are a lot of different people in the audience. I try to make it a bit general so it's accessible for everybody. And if there's one thing that I want you to remember is that a lot of technical trends are coming your way, and make sure that you have access to technical skilled people. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Lisbeth. So obviously there are a lot of things to think about when you're working with workflow automation and integration and APIs and everything. So what is and focus thinking about the future? What are sort of in your role?
Yep. When you're thinking about best of breed APIs and everything that I mentioned, we in Amfocus, and I'm sorry, I'm going now. I'm switching to our products, of course, because you asked.
I'm asking.
A long time ago, we saw that we are too small to do everything well. So a long time ago, we've decided to be open, to be more of a platform than a product, and to make use of all the different and good software vendors that there are in the industry. And we've created an open system so that it's very easy to connect to all of them. That's a route we've taken almost a decade ago. We've strengthened that vision with the App Store, which we created 4 years ago, I think. And it's only going further down that route, making it easier to integrate, and we're actually making some kind of a split. We are strengthening the offering for the technical people that want to integrate, that want to build things on top of Switch. We actually call those people the MacGyvers, who basically build anything with the tools that we provide them. But we at the same time want to make it easier for people who are less technically skilled to also automate more. So it's kind of a dual road that we're taking there. It's of course extending our ecosystem. So that's a bit.
Sounds a lot of things on your plate.
Definitely, yes.
Yeah, very good. So we're going to switch over now to our next speaker. As you know, we are keeping the time schedule. And how long will you stay, Lisbeth?
I'm here till tomorrow. So,
until tomorrow. So you can talk to Lisbeth and talk to the other people at Amfocus, because there are other people from Amfocus doing sessions also, and they are out in the discovery zone. So. Thank you very much again. Big round of applause. Thank you, Lisbeth.